Not that long ago, the element helium, the gas that fills everyday mundane helium balloons, was a total mystery. Despite being the second most common element in the universe, going straight back to the Big Bang, we didn't know it even existed until 1868. Here's the story. On August 18th of that year, a total solar eclipse was visible from the Middle East through South Asia. At the time, referred to as the King of Siam's eclipse, scientists converged and positioned themselves in the path of the eclipse to take some of the very first measurements of the sun's atmosphere with modern scientific equipment, particularly the spectroscope. The reason the solar eclipse was termed the King of Siam's eclipse is simple. The King of Siam, now Thailand, predicted this eclipse more accurately than anyone else in the world, much to the chagrin of French astronomers specializing in that field. The king's name was Mong Kut, and he was a former Buddhist monk that had studied indigenous astrology, but also scientific astronomy and mathematics, and was able to calculate the eclipse's parameters to a very high degree. Some years earlier, in 1859, Gustav Kirchhoff predicted that the lines that appear in a spectrum represent emission by the chemical elements. There are two types of lines here, emission and absorption. Absorption lines are called Fraunhofer lines. These mysterious lines had been known since 1802 through the work of William Hyde Wollaston and Joseph von Fraunhofer. The other are emission lines, produced by hot elements, stemming from the work of Kirchhoff and Robert Bunsen of Bunsen burner fame. It turns out Kirchhoff was correct, and we use emission and Fraunhofer lines in many areas of science to this day, especially astronomy. These things can tell you the composition of an exoplanet's atmosphere, or the composition of a star at distances of light years very reliably, not to mention all sorts of uses in chemistry in general. But back to the eclipse. This all led to a curious situation where a bunch of different scientists located in various areas in the path of the eclipse all noticed the same thing, an emission line where there should not have been one. French astronomer Pierre Janssen was one of the discoverers. He was situated in Madras, in India, with a spectroscope. During totality, he was trying to measure solar prominences that at the time he thought had something to do with sodium, but his spectra were not showing that. What he saw was a bright yellow emission line that could not have been sodium. But he apparently didn't think it was a new element. Independently, this was confirmed and also seen by British astronomer Norman Lockyer, who did think it was a new element. Other observers that noticed it were George Rayet, C.T. Haig, Norman Pogson, and John Herschel, and possibly others. The strange new element was then later observed in the sun without the need of a solar eclipse. What was it? Helium. And that's why helium has the name that it does, deriving from the Greek helios, or the sun. It's element number 2 on the periodic table, and incidentally was discovered in the eclipse just 1 year before Mendeleev unveiled the first version of the periodic table. It's the first of the noble gases in the table, and is as inert as it gets. It reacts with nothing under normal circumstances, though under very high pressure it can actually incorporate itself into atomic structures. But it's more the pressure doing that than anything helium wants to be involved in. The vast majority of helium appears as the isotope helium-4, most of which was forged in the Big Bang itself. But helium is also actively formed in the hydrogen fusion in stars, as well as some forms of radioactive decay. But for a long while, all indicators of helium were all in the spectrum of the sun. Here on Earth, helium was finally confirmed from geology, and it was coming from uranium ore. In 1895, Ramsey, Cleve, and Langlet found that helium comes out of certain geology, that which is radioactive. Reserves of helium were found in natural gas fields a few years later in 1895. The problem with helium on Earth, though, is that we don't have very much of it, and we're using it up rapidly because it has numerous uses. At some point, it's going to get expensive, and there will be no more helium balloons. We'll always have hydrogen, but helium is eventually going to be a problem because we have no easy way to make it, and Earth's supply mainly comes from radioactive decay. But that's a rabbit hole indeed, because there are actually a surprising amount of lifting gases we can use in its place. Helium is really useful because it's a strong lifting gas, and it's not flammable, whereas hydrogen is in Earth's atmosphere, see the Hindenburg. There's also coal gas, but it has less lift, is toxic and flammable, and contains carbon monoxide. Ammonia can work, but again it has less lift and isn't the best chemical to handle. Methane too, but it's flammable and better used to make hot air like that of the hot air balloons. All of those gases have been used in balloons, but there are other possibilities. Water vapor is lighter than air. The problem is steam is hot, so you need a material that can handle it. Worse is acetylene. It's terribly flammable. Hydrogen fluoride is even worse, but it's expensive and toxic and corrosive and just not very useful, as is hydrogen cyanide. Neon works, but it's expensive and in the same boat as helium. Very pure nitrogen is technically lighter than air, but not by much since the atmosphere is mostly nitrogen. Diborane can do it slightly, but it's as dangerous as it gets to handle, as is ethylene. The point is, we won't lose balloons altogether. We just have to expect a time when helium is rare and expensive, though there may be new sources of it yet to be found on Earth. It's been noted as a product, sometimes, of volcanic eruptions, and we know it accumulates on the moon. That scarcity will be an issue because we use helium for far more than just balloons. Helium's uses include cooling superconducting magnets, which MRI machines use, as a purge gas in industry, along with uses in arc welding and creating silicon wafers. Using very cold liquid helium is useful. Helium, however, gets increasingly strange the lower its temperature becomes. When you drop it below minus 268 Celsius, the colder you get, the greater the fraction of liquid helium goes into a superfluid state, flowing without friction. It's at this point the effects of quantum physics become evident, and things begin to happen that are not what we are used to in the normal world. For example, superfluid helium can climb a wall. It actually does this in its containers, where it climbs the walls, seemingly against gravity. You can also have a container that will hold liquid helium just fine without leaking, but can't hold superfluid helium because it does leak, because it can make it through pores that mere liquid helium cannot. Even more strange is the fact that superfluid helium may hold the key to understanding aspects of black holes, and may even lead to a coveted quantum theory of gravity, neither being things you'd really associate with helium. This gets into what is called a quantum entanglement area law, and the surprising thing here is that it can be observed in black holes, but also cold helium, which may be hinting at some kind of deeper connection between the two that we don't quite understand. Evidence, perhaps, for a deeper reality. Here's where this gets even stranger. We live in a universe dramatically subject to entropy, which defines the arrow of time and why it only moves forward. In short, as the universe ages, the tendency is for everything to move from a more ordered state to a more disordered state. Think of an egg. An untouched egg is low entropy. But when you crack it open and whisk it, it moves to higher entropy. But you can't unwhisk an egg. Thus, it's a system that can only move from low to high entropy. And that's how nature works overall. With a black hole, however, this gets a bit strange. In the 1970s, Stephen Hawking and Jacob Bekenstein determined that whenever matter falls into a black hole, its information is added to the black hole, which is basically entropy. The odd thing here is that it only increases as fast as the black hole's surface area increases. Increases in volume apparently don't matter. Say you have a small box. If you expand its size, you'd expect it to contain that much more information. That's not quite happening here. So here's the thing. This has also been observed for superfluid helium. If cooled to just 2 degrees above absolute zero, almost as cold as it can get, helium becomes superfluid with no viscosity and can then flow without losing any kinetic energy. Stick it in a container and spin it around, and the helium will spin forever. The reason for this is that in the superfluid state, the helium atoms quantum entangle with each other and can no longer be called separate atoms, but something else. Something new, as in they are helium, but the atoms are sharing their existence. An experiment using models made the connection to black holes. They basically envisioned a sphere of superfluid helium surrounded by more superfluid, and they looked at the amount of entangled quantum information that was exchanged as the size of the sphere was increased. This is like the information falling into the event horizon of the black hole, increasing its entropy, and lo and behold, the amount of information shared in the superfluid regions was determined by the surface area of the sphere, not by volume, just like Hawking and Bekenstein's black hole. We don't entirely understand why this is. Quantum entanglement is weird anyway. It made Einstein very uncomfortable, yet it is the case. Somehow non-classical information is shared, even over distance. So finding that simple helium that can be put into a superfluid entangled state here on Earth may yet give us clues on how both black holes work, but also lead us to a true quantum theory of gravity. I doubt the discoverers of that strange spectral line in the corona of the sun could have ever imagined the unbelievable scientific possibilities that lay ahead for the element helium. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently eyeing the moon suspiciously. It has a lot of helium, so much so that it's potentially on the agenda for helium mining. It's been collecting it since it formed as helium atoms stream off the sun. But why? What's it planning to do with all that helium? And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.